सर, गुड इवनिंग हेमंत सर.
गुड इवनिंग.
गुड इवनिंग.
वी आर लाइव इन 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन. वी वेलकम यू ऑल टू ऑर्थो टीवी ऑनलाइन. दिस इज अ रोजा वेबिनार इन एसोसिएशन विद राजस्थान ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जन एसोसिएशन. टू इंट्रोड्यूस टुडेज टॉपिक एंड स्पीकर आई हैंड ओवर टू रोजा सेक्रेटरी डॉक्टर राहुल कट्टा.
So, good evening, everyone. I welcome you all for this another ROSA webinar with the Hand Surgery, Jaipur Hand Surgery Association. And today's topic for the webinar is the current concept in the treatment of distal radius fractures. We have a galaxy of faculty today. Today's moderator are Dr. Amit Vyas and Dr. Atal Soni. So for the formal inauguration of this webinar, I would like to invite ROSA President Dr. Arun Vaishya to say something. Dr. Arun Vaishya, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul. I welcome on the behalf of ROSA, I welcome you all, Dr. Hemant and Dr. Amit and all national faculty who has joined in and who are going to present their cases and their inputs on distal and radius fractures. I hope this webinar is going to help all our colleagues in our state, and in also as we are on Ortho TV, it's going to help all over in India also. So I formally announce for the start of this conference, this webinar, and hope we learn a lot from this. Thank you so much. Welcome all.
Thank you, President sir. Without wasting time, now I hand over this webinar to our moderators, Dr. Amit Vyas and Dr. Atal Soni, to start the proceedings with the introduction of the faculty. Over to you, Amit and Atal.
Yes, thank you, sir. So, in our series of masterclass in hand surgery, today's topic is discussion on the distal radius fracture. We will discuss the current concepts of managing the distal and radius fractures, and also some practical tips for our orthopedic colleagues to deal with the distal radius fractures. You will be surprised that distal radius fractures are most common fractures seen in accidental emergency, and they consist of 3% of all upper extremity fractures. And second peculiar thing for these fractures is they have bimodal distribution. They affect younger age group between 20 to 40 years, where high energy trauma is there. And second age group is around 60s. So their osteoporosis is prevailing. So mechanism of injury is different. Some principles are different. In elders, extra-articular fracture is common, but in younger age group, intra-articular comminuted fractures are more common. And there is wide array of treatment from starting from close reduction, K-wires, external fixator, and even recently the columnar fixation of the distal and radius is there. So because the peculiar thing about Dr. Patankar sir is that his management changes with the patient. So according to need of the patient, he changes his treatment modality, and he has vast experience in the field of hand surgery. Basically, he is orthopedic surgeon who is accomplished in hand surgery, and he has a lot of attachment in Mumbai, like JDN Hospital, and also the most important thing is that his Patankar clinic at Chembur. I am fortunate enough to visit this clinic, and I should tell you that he has a very compact OT which has all the facilities in one small room, and he has a long academic career. He has 15 publications in the field of hand surgery. So our second speaker is Dr. Amit Varade. He is also orthopedic surgeon who is trained fellowship trained hand surgeon. He is working at Sopan Hospital at Nasik, and he is highly perfectionist in wrist arthroscopy surgery, and he is doing all the scapular fracture and wrist arthroscopic procedure routinely, and he will be sharing some cases about lower hand radius. So first of all, I would like to invite Dr. Hemant Patankar sir for his lecture on lower hand radius. Then it will be proceeded with the case discussion by our own faculty and Dr. Amit Varadar.
Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you.
And share the screen again.
Yeah, I'll share my screen. I think something is going on. Where is this gone? 1 minute. Yeah, okay, I got it. Yeah. Is this seen?
Yes, sir, go ahead, please.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rahul and Amit and Vinit and all the members of Rajasthan Orthopedic Society for giving me this opportunity to present my experiences. I will not say I'm going to teach anybody anything. As Amit has very rightly pointed out, this is probably the fracture that we grow up on in orthopedics. If we have not seen or the right from the first day of our residency, distal radius fracture is there at our command, at the back of our neck in the morning, evening, night. This is the fracture that is present with various configurations, various presentations, various social and economic aspects are there. So I will not go into the classifications which all of you, I consider all orthopedic surgeons as experts in distal radius fractures. I will just share my experiences, and I would like to I would like to know from the audience or from the faculty or the panelists what different they have seen, and I would like to learn something more on in a day, in this day, on distal radius fractures. So I will not speak about the angles and deviations and all the anatomy and all the various classifications, which are all confusing. Let us go to the practical aspects. The most important treatment, or the first treatment that we see as residents, is a close reduction and plaster. The problem is that many of times we don't, we are not taught, or we don't know how to give a plaster, or how to give a plaster in the correct way, so that we get a best result. Now, the best result means not a good looking X-ray. We have to analyze the X-ray. Now, this X-ray is of an elderly person, elderly lady. She is having all medical problems, and she refused surgery. On top of that, so she has refused surgery, and that's why she has come to us, come to me for treatment. So you can see that there is a dorsal angulation, there is a comminution, there is a positive ulnar variance, and you can see the fracture is generally quite bad. So this would have merited operative treatment. However, she refused surgery, but all the patients want a good result. So what is the option? option is under sedation because he is medically unfit. So under sedation and you give a plaster. So generally plaster means a plaster cast. So I don't believe that a plaster cast is very good method of treatment of these comminuted fractures, because then there is no access to the hand. You can't feel the hand. You cannot tighten the plaster because invariably there is a hand is swollen and the swelling will reduce with time. If the swelling reduces with time, the fracture will slip, which is the common story. And whenever we are treating all these patients with plaster, remember that the patient has to come for a follow-up for serial x-rays, or at least the x-ray has to be sent to us in this lockdown period. The x-ray has to be taken at the patient's home and sent to us. Now, what is most important in the plaster is that we have to do a reduction and reduction of the volar cortex here. If you don't reduce the volar cortex, the whole purpose of this thing is defeated. And another thing is, you can see I have marked these two lines, two red lines. And you can see a thick slab has been given. A thick slab has been given, keeping the wrist in flexion. Even I would say there is no harm in giving that so-called cotton loader position, which is supposed to be very dangerous. It is taught to us that it causes so many complications. It does cause complications. If you are aware of that, you know what to look for and you can avoid it. So I will explain the significance of these two lines and my way of giving a plaster now. So this, you can see these two slabs have been given here. You can see this one slab here and you can see this another slab given here. So what happens is, we generally, in our enthusiasm to reduce these patients with a plaster, we give both the slabs or we make a thick plaster so that it does, should not break. So it, that is right. But the thing is, by giving a thick plaster, we cannot get a hold on the reduction. So what I do is, I generally give half the thickness first, let it settle down, and then reinforce the previous plaster with either an RT cast or a synthetic plaster, or give another POP plaster, so that I give two slabs. You can see that the wrist is flexed. Now, as seen in this previous X-ray, the fracture is very well reduced. But the usual story, however careful you are, is that all these fractures will collapse. As long as they don't collapse significantly, as long as they don't cause DRUJ problems, then you will be assured of a good result. So you can see this patient was very happy at the end of 3 months. You can see that patient has got full function. Another picture which I forgot to paste in this slide is a picture of a fully working shoulder. Now, most of the frozen shoulders or the stiff shoulders or the so-called shoulder hand syndromes in these cases of plaster are because the surgeon has forgotten to tell the patient to move the hand and the shoulder. The wrist cannot be moved because the fracture is there and you are giving a plaster. So you are supposed to tell the patient and confirm that patient is moving the fingers and the shoulder when the plaster is being given. That is our responsibility to prevent shoulder hand syndrome. This is another case. Careful analysis of the X-rays is very important. Now, in this X-ray, in this AP view, what do we see? We see that there is you can see two lines here. This is the volar cortex, this is a dorsal cortex. And you can see that the fracture is angulated volarwards. So in this case, it is obvious that this is a volar displaced fracture. There may have been an intra-articular element here. However, it is not very significant because the joint line is seen. And you can see, when you see this pattern and the these two volar and dorsal articular surfaces so far apart, you can be sure that the fracture is volarly tilted. And here, what you can do is give a plaster, keeping the wrist in extension. You have to take serial x-rays in this case if you have to treat this without surgery. And that is how you can see that all the parameters are met. You can see this combination. The fracture is likely to collapse if you let go of this or if you are not careful. And you can see a very good result here with no collapse of the DRUJ. Another case. These cases where there is a fracture of the radius and ulna, these cases are slightly easy to treat with a plaster. Now, this patient was Again, he refused the plaster. You can see surgery. You can see the fracture line very oblique here. And this patient had a paraplegia. So for him to recover the wrist function was very important because he had to hold a walker to walk all his life. You can see that the fracture is reduced. You can see that the patient has recovered initial very good function. He is able to hold the walker to walk. And this is 1 year post-op. He has got fully painless hand with full pronation supination. You will see in all my slides, you will see every patient I have shown pronation supination because I believe that the painful forearm is the most significant cause of disability, followed by a stiff hand and a stiff shoulder. The wrist does not matter. And at 1 year post-op, you can see that the fracture is very well healed and he has got good function. Now, this avulsion fractures, you can take a chance. Generally, these are in, as Amit has said, that these fractures occur in young people following bike injuries or falls, very severe falls. Take a chance, give anesthesia, and you will be rewarded with a perfect reduction. This does not require surgery then. Provided patient is willing to follow up and you are willing to take that risk and maintain this hand in plaster, you may have to change the plaster if the swelling reduces. You will have to change it and make sure that you are giving only a slab. Don't give an encircling plaster in this case because then it is likely to slip and you will not be aware of it. Now, this is a case, again, this was a doctor's son, an orthopedic surgeon's son. He said, ki, somehow you try to reduce this or treat this without a without an operation. You can see this is a lunate diapunch fragment. I said, this will definitely require surgery. This was way back in 2005, about 16 years ago, where all these low profile plates and all these systems were not available. So I said, we will give a plaster under anesthesia, but we'll give anesthesia multiple times and keep on changing the plaster and give a tight plaster. Now that is a very dangerous word to use. A tight plaster means compartment syndrome, Wolfman's contracture. That is not so. If you're aware of it, you can give a well-fitting, I would say, a plaster, not a tight plaster, a well-fitting plaster. And you can see 6 weeks post-op, the DRUG is well reduced. The lateral view shows excellent reduction. And this is 5 months post-op. You can see all the elements of the fracture have well healed, no collapse at all. And this is the function of the wrist at 5 months. That's the function of the hand. And this is the function 4 years post-close reduction. So close reduction is not a bad method. You must know, you must analyze the preoperative X-ray. You must know when to do it, how to do it. And very important is very, very serious and serial follow-up. The follow-up is very important initially so that you must make sure that the fracture does not slip. And you are, and if it slips, you are aware of it and operate immediately. Nowadays, now many plates and many implants are available. So this is not very preferred method. Even I will not take a risk considering all these medical legal issues and patients' dissatisfaction and all that. So these were the cases done long time ago, 25 years ago, where implants were not so freely available, not good quality implants were available, and patients were not so much demanding as they are now. So you can see a very minimally displaced fracture, hardly anything to show in a meeting like this. Fracture obviously healed without any treatment, but with collapse. Patient went to an orthopedic surgeon. Patient was not advised anything and patient presented with a stiff hand. That is the reason is because he was given a plaster or a slab which extended beyond the MP joints. That is the one common mistake which is done, especially if the doctor has not given the slab, he has asked the compounder to give a slab. If the slab has been given or if a plaster has been given, make sure that it is not given on the volar aspect. And if it is given on the volar aspect, make sure that it does not extend beyond the MP joint crease. So this is not done. The plaster has to be cut or not to be given at all. Why cut it? Not to be given beyond the MP joint crease, beyond the distal wrist crease here. So that patient is able to flex the fingers right from the first day. Obviously, with this, patient must also move the shoulder and the fingers all the time. So when the patient present with stiffness like this, So when the patient presents with a stiffness like this, you give MP slings and start mobilizing it. So this is a contraption or this is an assembly which we give for MP stiffness, and that helps to relieve the stiffness of the hand and helps the patient to recover the function, because obviously there is nothing to do in the wrist. So MP slings are for the tractions to prevent MP joint flexion or MP joint contractures, and or to prevent early MP joint extension contractures. Never give volar slabs in such cases. So remember, in close reduction, anatomical reduction is very difficult to achieve, but can be done, and even more difficult to maintain. That is the most important statement, is more difficult to maintain till the fracture heals. The important thing is to restore the volar cortex. Once that is restored, things become easy. All fractures can be treated nearly in the wrist, except shear fractures and very highly comminuted fractures, especially in young adults. All the fractures will collapse to some extent. So remember that and tell that to the patient. And if the collapse is significant, the close reduction may have to be abandoned in favor of a surgery, currently in nowadays. And you expect a deformed wrist and a restricted forearm rotation if the collapse is missed. And if it is disabling or painful, if the wrist motion is or the forearm rotation is painful, the patient will need surgery. So if the close reduction is going to give such problems, so why not treat it operatively? And probably the simplest of the so-called simpler surgery is K-wiring. So K-wiring works in especially in bending fractures, and in some cases of avulsion fractures, well thought out cases, well planned cases, well studied cases. In avulsion fractures also you can do. Bending fractures, we have seen K-wires being put from in various permutation combinations. If people are happy with their results, they can go ahead. I don't like to insert K-wires from the dorsum of the wrist unless I open it. And I always prefer to have a limited exposure, identify the tendon and the superficial branches of the nerve, radial nerve, and then only put a K-wire. I don't like to keep the K-wires out because they are a source of infection and a source of pain. And pain means patient will not move and cause further stiffness. This is a very typical De Norfolk-like deformity in a very young boy. And this was a avulsion fracture. So here we treated this closed, but then it was apparently unstable. So I have treated it with very thin K-wires. Another thing I would like to reiterate in this meeting is that try to use thin K-wires. A thick K-wire does not give more stability than a thinner one. A well planned out and well thought out insertion of a thin K-wire gives adequate stability, because you can see that the length of the K-wire required is hardly 1 and 2.5 inches. So that is not going to bend like that. Obviously, you have to support this with plaster, and plaster also in line or in correction of the deformity. So that is the fracture which is healed. You can see all the views showing the excellent restoration of the DRUJ, especially DRUJ. And now we come to this, I would say, bread and butter of orthopedic surgeons: extra-articular fractures or the bending fractures of the distal radius. Remember that all these fractures will have dorsal radial comminution. They will have loss of volar tilt and loss of radial height. So this is a typical fracture. So you can see a break in the volar cortex. This is the most significant part. If you cannot reduce it, your treatment has failed. Again, you can see that the fracture is reduced. and fixed with K wires like this. I like to put a K wire from the radial styloid only as much as possible and support the hand with an above elbow plaster, keeping the wrist in supination and flexion. And obviously, after confirming that the volar cortex is reduced. Now, another very important point is this, the lateral view. What is important is we must remember that the radial styloid is a volar structure. And if the wire has to be inserted from the radial styloid, it has to go from volarly on the lateral side to dorsally. It cannot go on the same on the volar side, but it will not hold anything and it will come out here. So the direction of the K wire has to be from volar side distally to proximally dorsally, like this. As I've said, that I'd like to take a small incision. I would like to identify the branches of the superficial branch of the radial nerve and the APL and EPP tendons, retract them, and then only insert a K wire. Same goes for if necessary, you can insert a K wire from the dorsum of the wrist from the Lister's tubercle. But at that time, identify, and if necessary, shift out the APL tendon laterally and then insert a K wire. That is how we do it. I prefer to cut the K wire under the skin, but above the level of the tendons. I don't like to bend them because generally these bends will hurt the fingers because I like to move the fingers immediately after surgery. You can confirm that the tendon is gliding very well before you cut the K wires, so that you are sure that these K wires, sharp ends of the K wires, will not cause attrition rupture of the extensor tendons. So the most important message in this slide is to save the extensor tendons while inserting the K wires. So postoperatively, as I've said, I give an above elbow slap. I keep the elbow 90 degrees flexed. The forearm is supinated. The wrist is flexed. The thumbs and the fingers are free because the slab is dorsally. And start shoulder flexion and abduction immediately, like this. So what I do is I give this half of the plaster with a plaster of Paris. And so that to make the plaster lightweight, I give this part, which is going above the elbow with articas. So it becomes lightweight so that the patient does not feel too much weight on the shoulder and is able to mobilize right from the first day. You can see this patient is happily flexing and extending the fingers. And she will obviously get a very good result. So this is a case very typical dorsal angulation and comminution. We can see a sharp volar spike here. And that's the fracture, which is well reduced. Volar cortex is well reduced. And that's the function. You can see here, all the parameters of the distal radius are reduced or well achieved. Now, this is a very senior surgeon. The patient himself is a surgeon. He has got bilateral fracture after playing cricket. You can see all the elements of this extra-articular fracture are there. So this also was treated with a close reduction and K wires. As expected, this patient also had a collapse, but he has no pain on forearm rotation. So nothing further was done apart from removal of K wires. So, but that is not the case. If you do it carefully, you will get good results like this. If you don't do it carefully, if your K wires are inserted with a power drill, if the drill is having a low torque and high speed, the K wires will become loose and they will collapse and cause this ulnar impingement, painful rotation, and you can see serial collapse of this distal radius fracture. So you must know in which case you have to use a K wire, what to look for, and how to prevent complications. Now this is a complication, and you can see this case also the K wire is not inserted properly. If closed K wiring has to be done, the wire has to be inserted very carefully and judiciously, and this has caused a severe restriction of supination, and patient is in pain. This is not acceptable. Again, a case which has collapsed. So a positive ulnar variance is more disabling than a loss of volar tilt. And these patients will always keep on complaining if their forearm rotation is painful. They will not complain if the wrist is painful. So what are the options when such cases present to you? Do you always do a plate in these cases? I would say, please consider this method also. This is an anti-grade intramedullary fixation. Currently, or what we have seen up till now, was a retrograde intramedullary fixation. This is an anti-grade intramedullary fixation. This paper was first, this idea was published in 2002. This was expanded upon in 2013 by this gentleman. And so I've been doing about, I've been doing these cases when the patient has been a cooperative and very well counseled patient. I have been using this method of anti-grade intramedullary fixation using four 1.5 millimeter wires. Two wires are initially inserted in the anti-grade manner, and two wires are inserted in the retrograde manner through a limited incision. This is currently under review for publication, and you can see all the parameters of the distal radius are restored in these cases, even in the presence of dorsal comminution. This is the normal side for comparison. And you can see, this is a minimal access surgery, very well rewarding. It has to be supported with a plaster. And you can see that patient has recovered full function. Some patients come for implant removal, then we remove them. You can see at the time of implant removal, the volar cortex is very excellently restored. All the other parameters are restored. This is a preoperative X-ray for comparison. So this is another one or two cases. I'll run slightly fast. I know Amit also has some presentations. So this is another case. This is 18 months post-op. So the advantages of this method are it maintains the reduction which is achieved. So what is most important, it maintains the reduction. So reduction has to be done by the closed means. So this method maintains it. There is minimal collapse, if at all. It is minimally invasive. The total cost of the implants, 4K wires, is 200 rupees. If you went to put a plate, imported plate in this, it would cost 40,000 rupees. An Indian plate probably costs about 5 to 10,000 rupees, depending on what brand it is. So there are minimal complications if you take care of the skin, nerve, and tendon, which comes with perfect technique and attention to detail. You can use external fixation in such cases to augment if the fracture is highly comminuted, provided you get an excellent restoration of the articular surface. This is epiphysis pairing in children. I like to use this method, anti-grade intramedullary fixation, the anti-grade part only, in premature skeleton like this. This was a growing skeleton. I use this method by putting a single K-wire after close reduction. This is 1 year post-op. That's the result at 1 year. This is 10 years post-op. This patient is gone to become a doctor now. This is another case. You can see the K-wire is stopped short of the epiphysis here. So there is no potential or no chance of a growth arrest or growth problems in these cases with this method. Obviously, in this case, because the patient presented late, we had to do an open reduction. That's the function. Now, I have shown you cases of K-wires or closed reductions and K-wires where the patients have presented with an inferior radial ulnar joint subluxation. Now, this has caused a deformity of the prominent ulnar head and disabling and painful forearm rotation. So, what do we do in such cases? So either we, generally the story is that patient has gone to physiotherapist, he has worn a splint, taken medicines, but the pain is not relieved. You can see there is a positive ulnar variance. A simple method of treatment which I follow in well-counseled patient is a Milch resection or a segmental resection of the ulna here. It is a very, very well-rewarding surgery. Patient, we have to tell the patient that wrist movement will not change, but patient will get a painless forearm rotation, and that's what they want. They're not bothered about the wrist because, as you know, the radiocarpal movement is only 50% of the wrist movement. Other 50% is the mid-carpal movement. So this was a patient with a 75-year-old patient with the everything in medical history was positive. So this was initially treated with a close reduction. You can see a well-reduced or the decelerates is well-reduced. But however, with this combination, he is going to collapse with a plaster, which he did at the end of 3 months. He presented with a very painful forearm rotation, unwilling for, and probably anesthesia is also not giving anesthesia for a long time. And he was, you can see an ulnar impingement here. So he was treated with a Milch resection. The important or the funniest part of this surgery is that the moment you do this resection, the distal radial ulnar joint falls back in place. And that's a very important finding, or that's a very important observation, that the DRUJ falls back in place. That's the pre-op, that's the immediate post-op. And you can see at 1 year post-op, patient does not have a great wrist movement, but he's not bothered. He has a, most important, he's got a painful and full rotation of the forearm, which is painless. The painful rotation of the forearm is gone, and he's got a painless rotation of the forearm, and he's got full range here, and he's very happy. This is at 2 years. He has come to show me only to tell me that, to thank me, because he's got a painless forearm rotation and he can do everything with his hand. Now, this case was presented in an international meeting where everybody has given his opinion about various ways of correcting this distal radius and doing this plate and that plate and dorsal plating and external fixation, bone grafting and all that. However, patient was not interested in any of that. He wanted a painless forearm rotation. So, a segmental resection of the ulna. The wrist is happily myelinated. The ulna went on to reunite after the osteotomy. And he has got a full painless function of the hand. Incidentally, this patient is from Kota, Rajasthan. And that's the function of the hand. So this patient was treated with an external fixator. A very nice reduction, no doubt. The problem is these pins, if they have kept outside, and you can see even in spite of these pins, you can see that there is a collapse. And this collapse and the K-wire, which is very close to the DRUJ, caused a painful forearm rotation. Again, a segmental resection of the ulna. This patient had a stiff wrist, but a painless forearm and very happy. So that was the short take, my views on the distal ulnar osteotomy to restore painless forearm rotation. Now we come to some aspects about ulnar plating or volar plating of the radius. This is a very typical presentation. Young adult, bike accident, comminuted fracture, CT scan shows everything which is terrible. You can see a normal wrist here or normal carpal relations. So that's what I was mentioning. Remember this diagram or remember this picture always. So the mid-carpal motion contributes to nearly 40 to 50% or 40 to 60% of the wrist motion. So a hand or the fracture which comes like this, you will, in spite of a very good plating, you are going to expect wrist stiffness. If you can ensure that patient has got a painless mid-carpal joint, there won't be any problem. So these x-rays are experimental x-rays taken just to show that the mid-carpal movement also is very significant in a distal radius. So whenever you have got a comminuted fracture like this, very important is to restore the anatomy, obviously. Restore the radiocarpal and distal radial ulnar joint anatomy. What is most important is the restoration of function. In order of priority, it's the hand, forearm rotation, shoulder, and last is the wrist. CT, X-rays and CT scan are the mainstay of diagnosis. If necessary, you can take traction views and x-rays of the opposite side. I always take x-rays, four x-rays. I don't usually do a CT scan if the fracture is extra-articular. Very important, these views, a 10 degree true AP view and 20 degree true lateral view, which will show you the articular surface of the distal radius very nicely, like this. This is a 10 degree true AP view. This is normal AP view, just keeping the hand flat on the table. And if you tilt up the wrist by 10 to 12 degrees, you can see excellent, you can see this wrist articular surface excellently. Similarly, a 20 degrees true lateral view will also show you the alignment of the radiocarpal joint. I like to wait for 7 to 10 days for the swelling to reduce before I operate. This is controversial. People like to operate immediately. Fine. It depends on everybody's individual experience. I like to take a curved volar incision. I don't like to take a straight incision. That gives a present scar. For me, it gives a wider exposure. I find it easier to reach the radial styloid for either for putting a K-wire if necessary or for brachioradialis stenotomy, which I do in quite a number of cases. The dissection for the volar plating is between the FCR and the radial artery, as you all know. This incision should be avoided. Apart from these five tendons, flexor carpi radialis, flexor pollicis longus, brachioradialis, if necessary, APL and EPB, none of the flexor tendons should be seen when you're doing a distal radius plating, volar plating. The dissection will run through that. The most important thing while doing a plating is to prevent or see the flexor pollicis longus tendon very carefully and avoid its impingement or adhesions while doing the plate. And postoperatively ensure that patient is moving the thumb actively or flexing the thumb. Otherwise, the flexor tendon, flexor pollicis longus is likely to get adherent. This is also controversial. I find it very difficult to find the borders of the pronated quadratus to resuture it. It has been described by various people and various authors that it restores the integrity of the DRUJ and all that. I find that after plating, if you give a slab for about 3 weeks, the result is the same. Brachioradial stenotomy, especially when I find that the reduction is difficult or the fracture line is oblique towards the lateral side, I do a brachioradial stenotomy. Because brachioradialis, if you remember, that's the only tendon which is inserted onto the distal radius. All other tendons will cross the distal radius or the wrist joint and go into the hand. This is the only tendon that is inserted from the elbow and is likely to pull out the distal radius or cause difficulties in reduction. This is how you do it. Make sure that your this tendon is just on the just underneath the radial artery and identify it properly. If necessary, you can tug upon it and make sure that the thumb is not moving and you don't cut the APL tendon accidentally. Just cut the brachioradialis only. And just you can leave the tendon as it is. You no need to resuture it or do a Z lengthening, all that. As I've mentioned again and again, the reduction of the volar cortex is important even when you're doing a plating. That's the reduction, very important. And another very important consideration is reduction of the medial cortex. Many times we find this at the end of the plating. And what happens is not only that the DRUJ gets affected, but inadvertently the medial screw goes into the DRUJ because the assistant is not, or what I do is I ask the assistant to put a retractor here and pull the radial shaft laterally while I'm inserting the plate. So I get a very good reduction of the medial cortex. Watershed lines and Soong's criteria are probably, I would say, very ghisapita topic now in the whole of this, all these webinars, everybody has stressed upon it. I just run through it. Make sure that the plate does not cross the watershed line. Otherwise, it will cause a tendon rupture. The three grades are described. And this is the original plate described by or manufactured by AO is the only plate that is safe from the watershed line point of view. All other plates will cause some problems or some impingement of the flexure tendons if you are not careful. So even the volar variable angle locking plate, even the juxtaarticular plate, they are also prone to have problems with the flexure tendon. This is the safest plate to insert. You can see the problems with the proud plate. This is an Indian local plate, and this causes a flexure tendon rupture, required exploration and repair. Went on to recover. I like to use all the proximal screws as locking, as cortical screws. And first, obviously, you will do a sliding hole, adjust the plate with the C-arm, and then all I use all the distress screws and locking screws like this. The another very important consideration when you are using this sliding hole first technique is many times if the reduction is not perfect and we keep on tightening and loosening this sliding screw, what happens is many a times the screw suddenly stops holding the plate. And if you are using a two hole plate or a three hole plate, we don't have this screw to hold, give us any grip. So I generally like to use four hole plates nowadays, so that even if this screw does not give me the necessary purchase or the grip, then I can rely upon these screws for giving me the proximal hold. I don't never use a locking or non-locking plate in the distal radius, because it will invariably slip and all the screws will come out. Because as you know, there is so much comminution and so much osteoporosis, that these screws will never hold if they're not locking screws. So as I have mentioned, the proximally I like to use all cortical screws. Distally, I like to use locking screws or pegs. The direction of the screws is very important. I like to use the first screw, the ulna screw in first, and then I like to insert the screws from the ulna side to the radial side. The reason is that if you use the ulna screw first, then it's very easy to visualize the remaining screws. If you use the radial screw first, it becomes confusing and you cannot make out the intra-articular penetration. So that's why I always use the ulna screw first. Like this. I don't, for the distal radius fractures, especially in elderly people or when the bone is porotic, I don't use a drill bit for the distal metafascial screws. I use a 1.5K wire. I just puncture or penetrate the cortex or penetrate this cortex. I don't drill the K wire all the or screw use a drill bit all across, because as you all experienced, there is just nothing there. It's just all bone dust, really speaking. So you just make a hole for the entry of the screw and just measure the length and use the locking screws here. So all distal locking screws in osteoporotic bones. Now this is very important. What should be the length of the distal screws, distal locking screws? They should be 3 to 4 millimeters short of the measured length. This is very important, because what is seemingly a perfect length is generally always into the extensor tendons or coming out of the bone on the dorsal side. And it should not be more than the length of the lunate in the lateral view, like this. So in the lateral view, none of the distal screws should go beyond the length of the lunate. Or another simple formula is they should not go beyond the length of these shaft screws. That also formula works. So that's how you can see a true lateral and true AP view here. So to avoid extensor complications, you should have only unicortical drilling. Don't try to catch the opposite cortex. They should be at least 75% only of the length, not the full length. You can see this is just not done. I've already mentioned, it should not be more than the length of the lunate. Can cause extensor tendon problems. So I'll just give some examples of volar plates. I think I should finish in about 10 minutes more. I'll run through these slides. This example I like to show. This I've done about 25 years ago, this case, when there's a volar shear fracture and none of these locking systems were available and all, only the Ellis plate was available at that time. So this case was treated with open reduction and a innovative locking plate was designed on the table. The plate was cut. Only these two holes were available. There was no question of locking screws at that time. The plate was cut and the ends were bent. The sharp ends of the cut plate was bent and this gave me that locking mechanism and held the fracture well in place. And you can see this is an excellent result at 5 years post-op. Now there is no need to use imported plates or these all the other brands, fancy brands. If you can understand the fracture anatomy, if you are friendly with the plate and plate is friendly with you. So this is a typical volar Barton fracture or a shear fracture. What is required is a reduction, holding it in place and just maintaining it. You can use a local plate provided the distal screws are locking. If you are used to a local plate, if you understand its configuration, how the screws go and how the screws are held in that, you can use local plates also. I am not a great, or I would say compulsive fan of all the imported implants. So this is the very good result with this local plate. So this is a very important consideration, a very important case. This was an ophthalmologist who had a cricket injury on the field. And you can see a very small spike. This is a lunate die punch fracture. He, God knows for what reason, the surgeon waited for 15 days. The whole of the wrist collapsed here. On top of that, he operated the patient and did not pay attention to this volar die punch fragment, lunate die punch fragment. And in spite of the plating, the whole wrist has collapsed. So that has caused a severe restriction in the forearm. So this, I would say, is a calamity, surgical calamity, should not be done or should not be seen in anybody's hands. And I present a similar case. It came to me. He was also treated like this, not by me. And when I saw him, the whole wrist was collapsing like this. And so what I did is I used the same plate, just advanced it distally, and I could maintain the whole wrist in reduction with the same place, advanced distally with locking screws distally. What it really requires is this plate. Currently, this is a Zimmer plate, but currently with these flanges extension on the medial side, these flanges are not available. This plate is not available in India, as per my latest knowledge. And this gives you various other options. You can suture the capsule through this plate, and that gives a very good result in this lunate die punch fragment. This is a very specific plate, does not cause extensor tendon or flexor tendon impingement. So for extra-articular fractures, I like to use plates by these companies. They give you, the plates are very thin. They've got a very thin profile distally, and for extra-articular fractures, they give good results. I'll run through the cases. We have got less time and I want others to present their cases. And I'll just highlight a few examples of the volar locking plate here. This is another case. You can see the advantage of this DVR plate is that you can have this distal locking, or the radial styloid screw is variable angle. And you can really get a very flush fitting, which is not unfortunately available with the other plates. The problem with this local plate is you have to use additional K-wires, and it really does not support this smaller fragments, which is very well supported with this volar locking plate. The advantage of this plate, this is a synthesis plate, the advantage of this plate is you can really play around with the screws if you know exactly how to play around with it. If you know exactly where the screw is going to go, make sure you don't play around too much. Otherwise, the screw will go into the distal radial nerve joint and then it will be hell. Never accept x-rays like this where the metal rings are there. remove the ring and take an X-ray. You can see a very comminuted fracture. This according to me, with this configuration, this anatomy, it cannot be treated. It can be very well treated with this locking plate here, like this, paying attention to all the other aspects of this distal radius. This patient also is a very complicated case. You can see a severe collapse, very highly comminuted on the volar side. This was treated with a bone graft or the Cronos or the synthetic bone and a volar locking plate with a very good result. Again, a very comminuted fracture. Again, treated with a reduction and a locking plate here with a bone grafting here. Local plates, you can use them provided all the distal screws are locking. Don't bother, as I've said, a painless supple hand, forearm and shoulder compensates for a stiff wrist, which is expected with such a severe or comminuted fracture. Now, this is a slightly different combination of injuries. Now, here I've used a lock, interfragmentary screws. And I used the Indian local plate here. So it does not matter. You need not use imported plate all the time. As long as you understand the fracture anatomy, as long as you understand the plates that you are using, and you can use it in every case in your own way. And that gives a good result. So postoperatively, I suture only the skin. I don't take subcutaneous sutures. I give an above elbow slab in every case, in supination for 3 weeks and below elbow for 3 weeks, especially in comminuted fractures. And as I've shown you, I pay most of my attention to the shoulder hand mobilization, and so that I don't develop or get what is called so-called shoulder hand syndromes. So dorsal plating, is it coming back into fashion? Yes, I would say probably it went out of style because the plates were too big, too thick, and not very low profile. So indications of a dorsal plating are dorsal Barton's fracture, dorsal ulnar fractures, comminuted intra-articular fractures. As you can see, as you are experienced, we cannot see the joint from the volar approach. The only approach which helps us to reduce the joint, put bone grafts really after reduction of the articular surface, is a dorsal approach. So when you're doing it, then you can use a dorsal plates, you can with associated carpal injuries or a intracarpal ligament injury. So this is the when the intact volar cortex is there and the dorsal combination presents itself, or the patient, the whole wrist is shifted dorsally, you can use a dorsal plating. So this essentially, when the volar cortex is intact, especially on a CT scan or in the X-ray, the volar cortex is intact, there is no role for a volar plate. You have to use a dorsal plate. The dorsal plating went out of style because of the extensor tendon adhesions and the fear of loss of function and extensor tendon rupture. That was because of the plates are very thick. So how come it is becoming popular again? Because various low profile plates are available now. Now these plates are available with variable angle options also. The complications are really reduced with low profile plates. And obviously very important is to understand the anatomy, understand the plates and tissue respect. Various papers are now highlighting the advantages and the uses of the dorsal plates. What are the cautions and the tips used? I will not take a straight incision. I'll use a zigzag incision. I can address all the components of the wrist from the dorsal approach. Very easy to approach the radial styloid also and gives good cost basis. The approach is through the fourth dorsal compartment. Most important is you must lateralize the EPL tendon and you must trim the distal listous tubercle if you have to insert the plates, because the plate will sit flush on the bone. like this, lateralize the EPL tendon. This is again an illustrative case where there is a lot of combination here. However, the volar cortex is intact. Now here, you can identify extensor tendons properly. And then you can see this huge gap here. Now this was a arthrex dorsal plate used after bone graft. This whole thing is bone graft here. This was so comminuted after reduction of the articular surface. The whole thing was so comminuted that you had to use a block graft of the iliac crest. Another very important thing is that the plate should be trimmed and the should be bent. Don't take the plate as it is available in the set. Bend it in such a way that it causes pressure on the dorsal rim of the radius and bend it. Another very important thing I'll show you later on in one of the x-rays and is that the plate should look as if it is on the in the joint. I'll highlight this. Now this is a very important paper to prevent bowstringing and to prevent extensor tendon adhesions. You must design a retinaculum flap while you're doing a dorsal plating like this, so that the plate is covered and extensor tendon do not bowstring. So this important step, remember to do a retinacular flap. Now this was the same case where I used this dorsal plate. This is a very good plate, not easily available. You can see this incision, the fracture is gone to heal very well. And that's the function. You can see even the shoulder is normal here. Reported outcomes. Now everybody, a lot of papers are showing good results with this dorsal plates. You can see this excellent result here. You can see here, you can see that the plate is curved inside. It is pressing on the dorsal rim and 1 year post-op, very good result. Now that's what I was saying. The X-ray should look as if the plate is gone far distally. But it's really not distal. It is just pressing it. Here in case, there is some slight complication. The plate is not bent. So you can see that this plate is slightly proud and will cause extensor tendon problems. Fortunately, there were none in this old lady. Another case. Here also you can see that it looks as if the plate is quite distal. Like this. You can see here, this is the picture that we'd like to see in a dorsal plating. The plate, which is nicely curved here, you can see a true lateral view. Plate looks as if it is distal, but not really distal. And that's a good result here. Another case, now you'll see wonder why I'm showing you this X-ray. The X-ray is because there is an intra-articular combination. You can see in the CT scan with these two plates here. And went on to give an excellent result. We'll just run through it. Implant removal is not mandatory if you are using a dorsal properly contoured low profile plates. So yes, the dorsal plates are coming back in vogue, coming back in fashion, but you must use caution. External fixator, I'm just finishing, Amit. Please bear with me. This was a case, very highly comminuted fractures. Again, very highly comminuted. Not actually, now in this time, probably when you would like to use a dorsal distraction plate, they're not really available here. I have not used them. So we can use close reduction and K wiring and additional support with external fixator. Like this, provided you know how to manage the K-wires, you know how to prevent shoulder hand syndrome, how to prevent stiffness and mobilize the patient early. Now, this was again a nostalgic case for me. This is one of my first cases in practice, a very severe fracture. Again, no implants really were available. I was very new in practice. This was about 30 years ago. Sorry. So at that time, we were all just out of the external fixator school. So this was a very, I would say, very thick, very bulky apparatus which I used. But I got the result. I restored the anatomy of this patient. And this was, you can see, it was done in 1991, 30 years ago, this patient. Went on to give excellent function. This is 3 years post-op. I can claim now, or I can admit that I will not use this fixator again. It's very bulky, very difficult to manage, very cumbersome. That is probably because we did not have this locally made rod-to-rod clamps, the locally made AO clamps at that time. I don't use the Esquila clamps. I don't use the Jess clamps. I like to use these rod-to-rod Fernandez clamps. They are very good. They give you excellent maneuverability, excellent play. You can really play around with them and you can get a very good reduction. They are quite lightweight also, very easy to manage. They are not very costly. The local clamps are about 400 to 500 rupees per clamp. And you can really get very good results, early results and late results also. And like this, especially these distractors are reserved for highly comminuted cases. This probably I could have treated with a dorsal distraction plate, but I did not have it. I had done it in a Mofusil place. I could restore the DRUJ. That was my consideration in this case. Restoration of the DRUJ after open reduction and bone grafting. And that was the fixator I had applied. And this is 6 months post-op. You can see wrist is not very good. You can see wrist stiffness here, but patient has got full rotation, painless rotation of the forearm, no shoulder stiffness. And that was a good result. This is a case which was very badly managed. You can see this is how he presented to me after external fixator. This was the fixator that was used, was this favorite fixator, distractor so-called, with these Esquila clamps. This really is very unstable fixator. I don't use it. I don't recommend it also. Patient presented like this with exposed tendons, infection, and a lot of stiffness. This was, the whole thing was removed and I put a plate and a lot of splinting was required. After about 1.5 years, patient has recently come just about a week ago with this function. So he's very happy with this function. I'm not happy with the wrist and hand, but he does not desire any other treatment. You can use an external fixator to support a plate if the plate hold is not good. This was done years ago when locking systems were not really available. So if with the external fixator, remember that if the pins are inserted and the pins are not, if you don't take an incision, don't relieve the pain of the patient, you will get stiffness like this. I'll run through this case. I will not show you this case. Now, the last part, last two, three cases, when patient presents with very late, with a very stiff wrist and tired of all sorts of surgeries, this is a consideration, a wrist arthrodesis. Now, this is a case which has presented very late. He has tried all sorts of treatment, infection, stiffness, loss of no money, and the hand is stiff like this. A very simple method of wrist arthrodesis by reducing the bone, reducing the, or realigning the bones and putting two millimeter wires like this across the carpal bones into the wrist. And that gives you maintained with a plaster, that gives you a very good result. This again is a patient with a very old man with a lot of medical problems. Patient presented with a very stiff wrist, tired of all sorts of treatments, but wanting to have hand function, wanting to have a deformity correction. So this is how I treated his condition with a wrist arthrodesis with this retrograde wires. The wrist went on to heal very nicely. That's the hand function. That's the result. Sorry about the identity here. Another case. I thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, sir, for such an elaborative talk. And I think a wide array of treatment methods were displayed. And I think you are the only person who have used all the type of modalities, and you are master of all the things, because the main extract from your talk I got that you should be knowing the anatomy and what are the management principles, then you can use any implant and
yes.
to get the wrist range of movement. And most important thing is the getting the hand functions, finger function and shoulder movement, and prevent shoulder and hand disorders. So stiffness should be prevented in all lower and radius cases. This is the most important thing, is the message from this talk. I congratulate you, sir, for such a nice talk to deliver in our society.
Thank you.
We have a lot of questions, but I think we will discuss later, because I think another presenters should be giving, we should give time to them. So we will discuss later. So without wasting time, I would inviting Dr. Amit Varade for his talk, for his case presentation. Amit Varade.
Yeah, okay, I will share the screen.
Yeah, please share the screen. Amit Varade, he is working in Sopan Hospital, Nasik, as I introduce you.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, it's visible.
Yes, visible. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosa and Dr. Amit Vyas, for giving this opportunity. This 42-year-old gentleman had fall on outstretched hand due to fall from two-wheeler, and he admitted to the hospital on the same day. He had intra-articular Wohler-Barton type of fracture of the lower end of radius, and there was fracture of the ulnar stylet also. So he was operated on next day at another hospital by open reduction and plate fixation. So this was the X-ray after this surgery. So 15 days post surgery, he had fall at home again, and now we can see that the volar lunate fragment has come out. The distal screws of the plate are also out. So as this case is for discussion, may I ask Dr. Patankar sir his views on whether this fixation is inadequate, and what is his opinion about choice of implant, and what should be the distal level of the plate?
Can you just go back? Oh, okay. One slide back.
This is same, sir.
No, one slide, preoperative slide. Preoperative.
Preoperative, yeah. Okay.
Oh, I think surgeon should have, with this combination, he should have taken a CT scan before he operated it. And can you go ahead one slide? One
yes.
or two slides? Yeah, one more. Yeah, this slide tells you all. I think the surgeon used a juxta-articular plate without, I would say, getting any purchase or hold on this lunate diapunch fragment. So this whole wrist has started collapsing on the, or is falling down the valley, as it is called. So the main problem is not addressed. So this is a problem. I think a preoperative CT scan would have been important, very helpful, and a proper planning and all. I would say addressing this problem, this lunate diapause fragment should have been done.
Okay. And sir, about the distal level of the plate.
This is a gesticular plate. The plate has to come like this only. There is nothing wrong with the distal level of the plate. The plate will come like this if it is to hold anything.
Okay. So now, sir, what should be the plan of management in this scenario, and which challenges you will keep in mind while doing reoperation of the patient?
First, simply do a CT scan now.
Okay.
We perform a CT scan and get see the plates, and then go again, reduce this fragment. Probably will require a bone graft here.
Sir, may I ask one question?
Yes.
Sir, what are the indication of prescribing CT in your practice? Because I know you are, what is the judicious, I would say?
If I suspect the fracture is intra-articular, and if I think that the sigmoid notch is going to be affected, because as I've mentioned again and again, you'll say this old man is saying the same thing again and again. If I suspect that the patient is going to have a not going to have a painless forearm rotation, or if I am not going to be able to restore this part or the DRUJ properly, then I would go for a CT scan. The DRUJ, according to me, is the most important element while doing a distal radius fracture. This the sigmoid notch and the lunate diapunch, this area, this is the most important element. And you have to pay 100% attention while doing this surgery.
Okay.
So may I ask a question, please?
So any other faculty want to comment on plan of management?
Yeah, I actually need to ask a question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Bharati, do you think this fracture was due to the second fall, or primarily it was not treated well? According to the previous X-ray, apparently the fixation was reasonably okay. It is only probably because of the recent fall that he has sustained a lunate load type of fracture again. Is it not that?
Sir, I think the primary fixation is not adequate.
So you need to have some other X-rays, because the initial X-rays which you are showing, it probably shows a reasonable fixation. So, and there is a history of fall again. So probably it might have led to a fracture again. Maybe if you would have had a serial X-rays, then probably.
Yeah, actually patient presented with this X-ray to me. Okay,
anyways, go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So we did exploration. So since it is a volar lunate fragment, we did extended carpal tunnel release to get wide exposure of the volar lunate fragment. And we found that there were adhesions of the FPL tendon. It was released, and we have seen this suture material along the FPL tendon also. It was, the tendon was totally released. So, and we did fixation of the volar lunate fragment and distal radius with this plate. This is actually Smith and Nephew plate. Advantage is I was able to avoid the previously made drill holes, and there was good purchase of the volar lunate fragment with this with the two screws. This is 2 month follow-up X-ray, and patient has got reasonably good result, and he's still on physiotherapy. Thank you.
Dr. Amit, would you like to use more distal plates for your volar lunate fragment, or means what I mean to say, juxtaarticular plates or rim plates, particular in this case?
Okay. actually volar rim plate is there, which is with that we can fix the volar lunate fragment, and there are this hook type of plates are also there which can hold the volar lunate fragment. And particularly if we see about the fixation of the volar lunate fragment, there is one Moore's method in which we can use K wire to hold that volar lunate fragment, and volarly we bend that wire below the plate. So these are 2-3 methods we can use to fix the volar lunate fragment.
Okay, thank you. Any other question from other faculty or any comment?
Amit.
Yes.
Can I ask? I'm Dr. Mantri.
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah. I had a question with Dr. Hemant.
Yes.
Dr. Hemant, I have seen your cases which you have shown for fixation of the K wire. Do you go for the, you know, almost all cases like an exposure of that much exposure for the putting in a K wire?
No, I think the word that much exposure is probably for dorsal approach.
There is for not the dorsal approach.
Yeah. I always, yes.
You expose that much for putting another dorsal K wire.
What you see is just because of the retraction, you are seeing that much. It does not really mean that much. It's just a small zigzag incision. I like to identify the third and fourth compartment. Make sure that the K wire is not going into the tendons. But that will be real hell. I like to identify the extensor pollicis longus tendon. If necessary, shift it laterally. And then identify, make sure that the K wire is not going. In fact, I like to aim the K wire through the Lister's tubercle. But that is the area where there is no tendon. Definitely. And there is a hard bone there.
And my second thing, how many times do you come across for putting a multiple plates? Because there is a people in a various webinars and conference talks about the putting in a plate, one is on the lateral side and dorsal side and then ventral side, covering the R3
part. I think three plates are quite far-fetched. I've done 2 plates, one on the, but always there, I've not done volar and dorsal plates. I've done volar and dorsal and lateral plate, 2 dorsal plates, because probably the plate was not holding properly one plate. So it depends on actually dorsal plating of the distal radius is all, set of permutation combinations. You have to really go inside and then only make a final decision. You have to have a whole array of plates, the right side, left side plates, the straight plate, T plate, angular plates, all the plates, and also bone graft, you have to keep in mind, because this radial styloid plate also is very useful, but it all depends on the fracture configuration. Dorsal plating I have recently started doing. I was not a great fan of dorsal plating 5 years ago. I used to criticize everybody because the results were so poor. And then we started getting these low profile plates. We probably started getting more confidence in our own equipment and screws. And then we started doing dorsal plating.
Only last question. Just I want to ask Dr. Hemant, especially in a COVID period, which I have seen it, we have tried many cases with a close reduction and putting in a just only plaster and getting in a good results. So what do you feel that we people are doing, overdoing the K wire fixation?
Yes. No, not only K wire. I'm telling you, we are overdoing the plating also. But the thing is, the problem is this WhatsApp university. So the problem is that patients will send post-operative x-rays all over the world. And somebody will comment nowadays that this x-ray is not proper. The fracture is not properly fit. This has to be plated. Then it becomes a big problem nowadays. And the problem is in Bombay, especially, is everybody gives you that insurance policy and says, we don't want a plaster. More and more patients are highly demanding. It becomes hell. We are, I think, playing to the market. In Bombay, I think sometimes we have no choice.
Okay,
if the patient is willing to listen to reason, and the possibility that surgery may be required later on if the fracture slips, I will still give a plaster treatment for all extra-articular fractures, avulsion fractures, most of the patients, not shear fractures. Shear fractures cannot be treated.
Yeah, shear fracture cannot
be treated, but extra-articular fracture, I still give a plaster if the patient is willing to follow my advice and take repeated x-rays.
Okay, I have seen it in this COVID period only. Many of the fracture of the lower end radius, except as you said, it's shearing fracture, can be very well reduced in the local hematoma block.
I agree. Why block? Just pull it with a diclofenac injection.
Yeah.
Hematoma block is also not required. I agree with you completely.
Thank you.
Can we finish off with the case discussion first, Amit?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, you can share your screen and...
Yeah, okay. So I'll share the screen.
Up to the time Dr. Atal share his screen, Dr. Atal Soni is co-moderator with me, and he's active ROSA member, and he owns his hospital, Pragati Hospital, and works in Jaipur. So, sir, please continue.
Yeah. Yeah. Why? So you can see the screen and you can hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, fine.
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you.
Yeah. So this is the fracture, a 70-year-old female, domestic fall, and this is the fracture. So it looks like a regulation fracture, but apparently it is pretty comminuted, and all the parameters of a poor result, I would say. She has a bad combination here. Okay. So, yeah. So bad combination here, and a total loss of the radial length, and here of course the volar combination and loss of the dorsal length also. So, this was actually fixed like this. So what I was telling is that it's not a regulation fracture. It is a pretty comminuted fracture, as you can see here. So I will zoom it a bit. So there you are. It's a pretty comminuted fracture here. So it was externally fixed, external fixation, and few KYs dorsally and a radial KYs. So this was the fixation, though looks reasonably okay. The radial length apparently is restored, the DRUJ apparently restored, and the joint line appears to be okay. So I'm sure it would invite too many questions. One, two questions, Dr. Patankar, if you want. You are mute, sir.
Yeah. Sorry. It all depends on what was her requirements. If she was medically, how she is medically, and whether it's a dominant hand, whether she is active in life, she's doing all the cooking and all those things at home. Or she's just...
She's a 70... T-score was 4.5, so she was pretty osteoporotic.
Yeah, her left hand. Looks, yeah, it's seen.
Yeah, left hand. And yeah, I mean, she's working, not a sedentary... I mean, sedentary household worker, yes.
Yeah, but here, I would say this is a good fixation, no problem. And considering all the other circumstances and this very highly comminuted, I would have given the choice of a bone grafting to this patient, because then this fracture will, if the fixator is removed, this will collapse. 100% will collapse. It is not going to heal on its own.
Absolutely.
Because otherwise you have to keep the fixator for 3 to 6 months.
Absolutely, sir. That was the reason of asking
Dr.
you, sir.
Atal.
Yes.
Only I want to ask what the K-wire is serving to you in this case. Amanda also commented even putting in a single fixator and maintaining the length is good enough. Then putting these two K wires which are going into the long K wires.
These K wires are very important, according to me. They're long, forget about that. But the K wires are very important because these fixators, this particular fixator will not give you any inter-fragmentary alignment. Don't expect that this just distraction will hold this radius in length. The K wires are holding it in length. K wires are holding the reduction here. What this fixator is doing is preventing collapse.
The K wire which they have put it only in the intra-articular fragments only, instead of putting in a diaphyseal region, putting in a little bit longer toward the radius side on diaphyseal.
No, if the K wire were not put, the whole, in spite of the fixator, the whole distal radius would be all wonky. This would not hold at all, because that has been my experience with this assembly. This mini Hoffman type assembly is there. This is a very unstable assembly. It only gives distraction. It does not give correction of any angle. So these K wires are important, but they are important only for limited period. This has to be bone grafted, otherwise it will collapse. Everything is going to go.
Any more question? Yeah. Amit, you are...
Patankar, sir, you told that this type of assembly is not stable. So what is the stable assembly?
I have shown you. The mini AO clamps, the Fernandez type clamps. The ones which I showed you in my presentation. That's the only stable thing. I have tried everything. Nothing works. This all are unstable assemblies. This will not permit. This have some movement in them. And when the patient starts moving the finger, suppose we tell abhi ungli chalao, so that you want to recover the hand function, they will not move it because they'll get pain with this assembly.
And
we have seen collapse in spite of this assembly.
Second thing, you told that it will require 3 to 4 months to prevent collapse.
No, you may have to maintain the fixator for 3 to 6 months for the fracture to heal without collapse, without bone grafting.
Okay, without bone grafting. Is it possible that after 6 to 8 weeks, you can remove the assembly and can maintain in the cast?
Everything will collapse.
Everything will collapse.
Guaranteed. Okay. Especially in this case.
May I go ahead?
Yes, please.
Sir, your words are absolutely golden, sir. I would really salute you. Your words are really golden. Whatever you said just now is absolutely gold, sir. 100%, 24 karat gold. But the problem is that we are so complacent. We are so complacent with the distal radius fractures. We almost always think that distal radius fracture are easy fractures to treat, and they probably are going to unite all the time, and whatever you do, probably with some minor tilts here and there, minor malunions, you still might land up in a fair enough result, which is not the case. So, and whatever you said just now, you can see it for yourself in the next slide. So this fixator was kept for, I think, 6 or 8 weeks, not very sure, but yes. And after removal of the fixator, this last x-ray is after 6 weeks. This x-ray is after 6 weeks. And after this, the patient was kept in the fixator for another 2 weeks. Then the fixator was removed. Then the patient was put in a plaster, and this is 1 month post plaster. So this is 3 months from the injury.
So she will have a stiff hand, deformed hand. It looks stiff also here. You see the fingers are in extended position here. Maybe an X-ray appearance, but with this appearance and the wrist, the ulna impinging on the carpus, we are heading for trouble.
What trouble, sir? What trouble?
Stiffness, deformity, loss of function.
What do you suggest at this time, sir?
See, that's what I said. It all depends on the patient's attitude towards life and their her relatives' attitude towards you. And you means the, I'm not saying you, it's a surgeon. So now if the simplest way out, if the patient wants something simple out of this, because now the fracture is united. The fracture is united with the malposition, obviously. Now if the patient comes and in this case with a 70-year-old lady who is not really very active and all that, I would give them an option of doing an ulnar osteotomy here. Just do
ulnar osteotomy. So and that is exactly what we thought, that let the fracture unite even more and then we'll do a direct or something like that and give her a painless wrist and probably that would be it. But that was not to be it, sir.
Oh, non-union.
Yes, sir. So this lady went into a non-union. So now... By the time we were thinking of directs and the X-ray after 1 month shows this.
Okay. Can I comment?
Sure, sir. Sure.
Yeah. Now again, I'll say again, patient counseling and patient requirements and all that. Now this case with this thing, I think surgeon and patient will be both tired of each other. What you should do is open this here, open the fracture here. Remove the segment of the ulna, put it in the fracture site and do a wrist fusion by putting 2 K-wires here. Forget it, finish the matter. Okay.
So, nearly did what you said, not the wrist fixation, not the wrist fusion, sir. She had a reasonable joint movement at the wrist. So, okay. We did a direct and put a, of course, resected the non-union and put a tricortical bone graft.
Okay, fine, graft, fair enough.
And this united. And she now she has a reasonable good looking wrist and reasonable range of movement.
The ulna could have been resected more than this.
Yeah, right, sir. Right. Probably half inch more. Yes.
Yeah. Good result. Good case.
Yeah. So I'll go back here. So at this, sir. Should the surgeon would have done a plate, or this is okay, or if this is okay, grafting was mandatory. I think that was the only thing which probably would have been done.
And this time you could have avoided doing a plate by doing a bone graft, or else with this current Western literature, this was ideal case for a dorsal distraction plate.
Hardly any space left for any screws in the distal cortex. Probably hardly.
That's what I'm saying. Is a dorsal distraction spanning plate. Nothing in the distal radius.
Okay. Spanning plate. Okay.
Yes, spanning plate. No. Two screws in the metacarpal and 2 screws in the proximal radius.
So it's sort of an internal external fixation.
Yeah. It's that plate has now replaced all the external fixators.
Mm-hmm. No experience there actually. Yeah.
Neither here.
So probably, sir, probably in this case, rather than putting a plate, putting this type of fixation is fine, and just putting a bone graft would have saved the life, because extending the fixator for 4 months, 3 months. Probably wouldn't have helped.
No, it doesn't help at all.
Yeah. Any more questions?
Sir, can you scroll next slide? Or next? Yeah. At this stage, as finger was stiff, so...
No. I mean, maybe the X-ray shows so, but the patient has, I mean... Since it was my case, we were full on with the physiotherapy of the wrist, of the fingers and elbow and shoulder and all. So the movement was not a problem. It was just the deformity and the non-union. Yes.
Sir, just my apprehension is that patient probably as retrospectively, we can think that this fracture has not united. So it is quite difficult to move fingers with this ununited, painful fracture. Right. So... what you do, I have done in few couple of cases that don't jump to another surgery. Just give him a well-molded cast and your trim line should be excellent, and you can start moving the fingers. So it will give opportunity to fracture to heal properly, and you will gain the finger movements early. So probably this situation would have not achieved if at that stage it has been done.
But in any case, Amit, the fracture would not unite. No?
Yeah, you know, just I am thinking retrospectively. So
yeah, what he is trying to say is that in the interim period, you mobilize the hand and fingers so that you are preparing for the next surgery.
Yes, but that stands true for any fracture for that matter.
Yeah, any. That's true. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, so I'm done. Amit, you can go ahead with the next.
Any other question for this case? Otherwise, I will invite Dr. Deepak Jain for presenting his case. Dr. Deepak Jain, he is presently executive member of the ROJA, and he is working at Ajmer. So, Dr. Deepak, please share your screen.
Yeah, I'd share my screen.
Dr. Atul Soni, please.
Stop sharing your screen.
Stop sharing. Atul, sir. Probably he's relieved. So, just a minute, I will call him.
Okay. I think my screen is visible now.
Now it's visible.
Okay. So good evening, everybody. Today I'm presenting a case of distal radius fracture. First of all, I'd like to thank Rosa and all the hand surgery members for giving me the opportunity to present a case and be a part of this webinar. So that's a 43-year-old male patient met with a road traffic accident, injury right wrist. He had no comorbidities. So that's the fracture on the dorsal side and that's the radial side. Anybody would like to comment on the fracture at this stage?
CT scan.
Yes.
That's a zoomed in view, but the CT was not done. So probably I thought that's a radial fragment and that's a dorsal fragment.
Okay.
I think the radial styloid is fractured vertically.
Yeah. So CT was not done. An important thing to be noticed is that he had thumb aplasia. So that's the one slide back. There was no thumb and associated carpal abnormalities. I'll just skip the classification part. So what are the options at this stage? Dr. Vineet? Amit, sir, would you like to comment the plan of...
I think there is ulnar styloid fracture also, which is from the base. That is number one. And in such cases, it is better to have traction views.
Yeah.
If you are not doing CT, then traction views will help to understand the position of the fragments.
Yeah. So what's the plan for the management at this stage?
Volar approach, bone grafting, and putting a plate, fixing it with a Volar plate.
So the fragment looks dotty.
Displacement also.
That can be grabbed
from the Volar plate.
Grabbed through this.
From the Volar plate, we can catch the dorsal fragment.
Yes. No, you have to. You will have to. The whole thing is dorsal here. This whole complex is dorsal piece.
Dorsal.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. This along with this, the whole thing has gone dorsally.
Yes.
Yeah. This is a good case for doing a dorsal plating. Because you will require an interfax screw like this. which is very difficult to insert from the dorsal side. So you require interfax screw here, and it requires a bone graft also.
So it prefer as a volar plate or dorsal plate?
Volar plate in this.
How to address this large dorsal fragment?
You can grab it through volar screws.
Dorsal plate.
Once you give traction, everything will fall back in place in this case.
Sir, what you is bone grafting?
Holding the hand in traction.
Sir, you
can see here that this articular surface is looking quite strong here. So probably you'll be able to insert or put a good plate here from this side.
Why not a dorsal one, sir?
Gut feeling.
And sir, what is role of bone grafting you were telling?
Yeah, there is a lot of combination here. I would suggest that at least we prepare for bone graft.
Okay.
That's all these questions are dicey because we don't know. What is really going on in this with the CT? Probably things would have been much more easy. Would have been able to plan properly. We would have able to see the sigmoid notch also properly. So we have to, once we don't have a CT, we have to plan for everything. Once we, you're right, I'll get a, when I get order the set, I'll order a dorsal plates also in this case. I'll keep an external fixator also handy in this case. I'll keep everything handy.
So, right, sir. I kept both the plates. But yeah, we plan for the dorsal plate and that's the intraop AP view. Is this reasonable?
DRUG doesn't look reduced.
Have you, there is ulnar styloid fracture. Have you checked the ballotment post fixation of the radius?
Yeah, it looked reasonable. I thought of putting some K wire, but it looked reasonable. But the lateral view was not satisfactory. That piece was not holding. So what can be done at this stage in drop?
And did you contemplate a bone grafting at that time? The patient prepared for a bone graft.
So I discussed with him, but really I was at that stage, I thought the cortex was good. So AP view looks good. So I didn't contemplate the bone grafting, but the lateral view, that piece was not in position, volar piece. So that initially what looked to be a radial styloid came out to be the volar piece. Here it looks to be dorsal lateral. Radial styloid, but here it looks came out to be volar piece.
Oh.
So what can be done at this stage? It's in drop.
My God. You have to do bone graft. You have to either, otherwise you have to put a volar plate now.
So you go volar again now.
Yes. But then how are you going to fill up this loss here? The plate is not going to compensate for the bone loss.
Yeah, you go volar and then...
You go volar and put another plate volar side.
I decided on table to go volar. And luckily I got that piece reduced and got one screw through that fragment. So got a good grip and tightened that same screw slightly longer and got a good grip in that fragment. And I think it's a reasonable position of the fragments. Is it satisfactory now?
Very nice.
Yeah, look good. Looks good.
How was the stability of the distal radial ulnar joint?
That's
from the base.
Not address that ulnar styloid, but that's the post-op X-ray.
May I comment?
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Varade is quite right that distal radial ulnar joint is not addressed, but I think patient is having thumb aplasia and maybe some component of radial dysplasia. So,
the radial height is not proper. So even if we see that,
that factor should be considered.
Yeah, that's why I checked the stability of the DRUJ looked reasonable, so I probably decided not to touch that, and that's 3 months post-op.
What was the opposite side?
So opposite side is normal.
Okay.
Thank Only God. On the right side he had that thumb aplasia.
Okay, good. So then he may be having a thumb aplasia with a slight radial shortening from birth.
Yeah, it looks a lot of shortening if we consider this. It's a lot of shortening. It's almost same as...
He will have a good forearm rotation, but...
Yeah. It's got reasonable function at present now. It's almost 9 months to 10 months post-op. He is satisfied. He's driving his two-wheeler again. So probably what you said that I should have done some traction view or CT scan. And second thing, we should plan for combined approach if required and keep both the plates ready. If we see such condition.
Another thing I would suggest is suppose you don't have, suppose patient is having too much pain for traction views, then what you can do in such cases when CT scan is not available or not patient is not willing to spend, you take 4 views of the distal radius.
Yes.
2 more x-rays.
Yes.
That will give either probably some more knowledge.
Yes.
Yeah, one more question. Now, are you happy that you have done a dorsal plating, or you do you still feel that that volar plate would have given you a good same result?
So probably I thought if I had tried volar plate, I would have opened a small incision on dorsal side to reduce that fragment properly. Because if the holes are not drilled properly, that fragment might not have reduced. So probably if I plan volar plate, then I'd open slight small incision to reduce that. That's a big fragment. So small incision can reduce the fracture and we can hold it from the volar side.
But even today, one should not play around with dorsal plating as much as possible. As much as volar plate are still the gold standard.
And yes,
it will give the best results. Even dorsal plates, you are playing with fire actually. You are getting away with good results is a different thing.
But so the problem was... I thought that the piece was on the radial styloid.
No, I agree. You have done a good job.
That was a mistake. I should have done the CT scan.
No, the dorsal plating is, it's good then. So many implants, low profile plates, AO, synthase, all mini drills, everything is available. That's all fine. But playing around with extensor tendon is still dangerous.
Yes, sir.
So
it's difficult to release the retinoclem, release the tendons, and it takes a lot of time to expose.
Yes.
And probably mine first case for dorsal plating. I always do volar. That's the only dorsal plate I've done.
It's a good case. Good case.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
It is nice case. And one thing I want to comment here that I am always apprehensive in putting the distal screw with the dorsal plate. So if wrist is dislocated dorsally, only buttressing effect will neutralize the fact.
Yeah. So, doctor, can you go one slide behind? One slide back? Yeah. Now here this thing. Actually, when the real and the dorsal plates which are described, they don't describe insertion of screw or insertion of the plate or location of the plate like this. This dorsal plate, the real dorsal plate has to be seen in such a way as if it is distal. It has gone into the wrist.
Yeah, the
plate is only more from
distal to proximal.
This plate is potentially going to be a proud plate for the extensor tendons.
Here the volar, one thing I would like to comment, here the volar inclination of the distal radius is 0 degree. So that is why the screw is not going into the joint. Otherwise, it would have gone into the joint.
Yes. No. The real reason that the screw is not gone into the joint is because this dorsal plate is not distal. If it is inserted properly distally, as described in the literature of all these dorsal plates, the screw should have been coming from here, going into the at an angle. The screw is at 90 degrees to the plate.
Yeah, which so I think it's the large fragment, so I kept it.
I see. You got a good result. You got a good fixation. I hope your extensor tendons also are normal. So, but the dorsal plates distally, we hardly put any screws. The plate is only a buttress plate.
There. Yes, sir.
and the molding is your choice to mold it according to the contour of the
dorsal. Yes, that is very important. That is very important.
Otherwise, you cannot maintain the dorsal tilt.
Yes, exactly.
And I think Dr. Deepak has said the right thing. If you are putting a volar plate and you have a large dorsal fragment, go dorsally, at least reduce it. And your screws should have a purchase of the dorsal fragment.
Yeah, so they should grab it. Not right. Out. Exactly. Yes. Right.
Should I stop sharing my screen?
Yeah, yes, please. Dr. Rahul Katta, sir, do we have time for one more case or shall we finish?
Patanka, sir, can I ask one question?
Yes.
So when you describe about the anti-grade K-wiring, what size of hole you drill? It's a bigger hole, and how the K-wires hold in that hole?
Oh, this is an interference fit. It's a 2.5 millimeter hole. Yes.
And there's no problem with backing out of the
K-wires? The interference fit is so perfect. I have to convince the patient to come for removal. I don't advise them, but if they want removal is become the, they don't come out easily. You have to really give a big, nice jerk to remove the K-wires. They never back out. They are not back.
Just fit it tightly in the holes, two wires from that small hole.
Two wires centigrade from the single hole and two wires retrograde from that radial styloid.
Yes.
So may I ask a question?
Yeah.
So apparently, sir, your anti-grade wiring is working on the principle of Ender's nail, probably, I guess.
Yes. Agreed.
Second, sir, one question. You almost left doing a directs and you're doing just a ulnar resection now?
Yeah, I don't do directs at all. I do only Milch resection.
Okay. And third, sir, how often do you do a bone grafting once you anticipate there is a combination? So how frequently do you do bone grafting? Have any rule of thumb?
Yeah, no, quite frequently. If I am expecting, because nowadays in Bombay, with the type of practice I have got and with the loss of hair that I have, now I am regarded as a senior surgeon. Problem is in our hands, we cannot have the patient going to the second person for second opinion now. So we have to give the complete treatment. So the patient has to be in a one-stop good result. So we prepare for everything. Whenever I order plates or for the distal radius, I order the whole set, dorsal plate, volar set, volar plates, double set of screws and external fixator is always handy. And we tell the patient always we do a CT scan now. If there is a more combination, especially in intra-articular fractures, even in the non-articular fractures, if we have any doubt, then we do a CT scan and we always counsel the patient, tell the patient that there may be a need for bone grafting. If not bone grafting, at least Kronos, at least the synthetic bone we insert and restore the articular surface and then only put a plate on top of that.
No, sir. I was asking in the percentage terms, how many times do you do a bone grafting, sir?
In the 25%. Definitely. Oh, okay. Yeah.
25% of the selected comminuted fractures or the distal radius fractures, sir?
Distal radius fractures. Not selected. Selected everybody.
If the that is substantial.
Yeah, we do at least putting Kronos. At least not for autografting or iliac-based grafting, but Kronos definitely we are inserting.
Right.
And second, sir, why don't you prefer Suve-Kapanji procedure instead of ulnar segmental resection only?
Ulnar segment resection is simple.
Okay.
It is done in 10 minutes. Suve-Kapanji, matlab it is to direct a screw from the ulna to the radius. It has to go properly. You have to do arthrodesis. There is no need for arthrodesis. What you require is just to restore the DRUJ. That is enough. And even after Suve-Kapanji, the problems of the proximal ulna remain. So that also has to be stabilized. So if the ulna, proximal ulna is wobbling too much, I put a K wire from the ulna to the from the distal ulna into the ulnar shaft and keep it for about 6 weeks, so that all the soft tissues form around the non-union site or the osteotomy site. And many times the fracture will unite with the restoration of the DRUJ, as you have seen from that case which I presented from Kota. The fracture united very well, and that, or the, I would say the osteotomy united so well that the patient is absolutely fine now. One should go for simplicity and of the procedures. The more complicated you do, the, you will get complicated results only.
Amit, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, sir.
So should we conclude the meeting?
Yeah, yes, sir. So we have one case. If you, otherwise, we can conclude.
Maybe in another 5 minutes, if he can sum up.
Yeah, Dr. Vineet, can you sum up your case?
Sorry, not able to give talk this time because of loss of internet connection on the mic.
Okay, thank you. So, I'm concluding the session. I think the distal and radius fracture have variety of treatment, and my thinking to invite Dr. Hemant Patankar sir was that he is the person, he is using all the modalities and he has vast experience, and I think it is clear from his talk only. And the main thing, if you are, even if you are attempting close reduction, then maintaining the close reduction, you should know how to maintain the close reduction. And the second thing, finger mobilization and shoulder mobilization should be taken care. And if you know the how to manage the anatomy and the kinematics of the lower end radius, and you know the management principle, you can use any of the fixation device and you can get the good results. So with this, I would hand over to Dr. Rahul Katta sir for
thank you our national faculty members, Dr. Hemant, Dr. Amit, and our Rosa faculty, Dr. Mohan Mantri, Dr. Atal Soni, Dr. Deepak Jain, Vinita Roda, of course Dr. Amit Vyas, for a nice discussion on the distal radius fractures. So as we all know, these fractures are not forgiving fractures, and there are vast variety of presentations of these fractures. So there are vast modalities of treating such kind of fractures. Even in the meta-analysis, there are no consensus for a particular kind of treatment for such fractures. But today, with the experience of our faculty members, we were able to learn how to deal with the different kind of fractures with the different modalities. So thank you so much. On behalf of ROSA, I'd like to thank you everyone, all our viewers, and of course the Ortho TV to providing the platform to us. Thank you. Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Amit Varade. And